Nice and loud, Mr. Wheaton.
I'll try.
Mr. Wheaton, I went over your team's qualifications, but could you briefly tell the council about your background and experience in your and HDR's role in this project?
Okay. I have 28 years of experience in the engineering field, focused on power generation facilities. I graduated with a degree in electrical engineering from Michigan Tech in 1987. Initially went to work for the power company, Consumers Energy. And in the early 90s, I transitioned to the engineering construction field and worked for a firm called Black & Veatch, doing design projects for power generation facilities, primarily natural gas, throughout the United States. 10 years ago, I joined HDR, which is a consulting engineering firm. My role on the Lackawanna Energy Center project is to support the project from a permitting perspective and a conceptual engineering perspective. I act as the project manager for the county.
Are you a licensed professional engineer?
Yes, I am. I'm licensed in the states of Michigan, Florida, and Illinois.
Could you walk us through some of the parts of the application that HDR was responsible for?
Okay. Section one is a general description of the proposed project. Some of the best information available is in the various figures, and I'll just point to what's on each figure, and you can open your books if you like, or I'll summarize it fairly quickly. Figure one is the site location. It's an aerial view, essentially a map of where the proposed project would be located. It's southeast of the Casey Highway, southeast of the borough of Jessup. The proposed facility boundary is shown, as well as an overview of the various components of the project. Figure two is...
Before you get figure one, Mr. Whitman, just so we're clear, could you describe for the council what will be, because it's a Pompeii parcel and it's a cinema parcel, if you can describe for them what each will be used for.
Okay. The Pompeii coal parcel is approximately 65 acres. That will house the actual power plant itself. The adjacent cinema parcel, which is approximately 56 acres, will serve as construction laid out.
Once the project is done, that parcel won't house any project facilities?
No, it will be returned to essentially the pasture conditions of it.
Will it be owned by you?
Yes. The question was, will it, I could clear up here if I answer that.
I could wait till the end.
Okay. Exhibit two is our purchase option. We were required we will be buying the property. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Figure two is essentially the same aerial photograph. It shows the proposed facility, its boundaries. The information that's presented here are the setbacks from all existing developments and various compass angles around the facility. And then the purpose of the demonstration is to show the setback distance exceeds the 2,000 foot limit that's spelled out in the ordinance. I'm going to move to what is figure three. And these are relatively large, full scale, full size site arrangements or site plans.
Figure 3A
is the first one. And figure 3A shows, to a larger scale, the parcels that we just discussed. It shows the setbacks. It shows the general location of all the project facilities, the surrounding areas, the highway, the Grassy Island Creek, the PD&L substation. And what figure 3A is based on is the base design of the project facility, and it's what we call the multi-shaft configuration. And that has to do with the actual configuration, how the power plant equipment is arranged and operates. There are, in the lower left portion of the drawing, there are three combustion turbine heat recovery steam generator trains. Those three units supply steam, in this case, to a single large steam turbine generator. And that also includes a air-cooled condenser for the single steam turbine generator. Figure 3B is the same general information presented. It's the site plan, the site arrangement, the background information. The difference being that the power plant configuration is slightly different. This is what we call the single shaft alternative design. And what you'll see is there's a separate air-cooled condenser for each of the three combustion turbine heat recovery steam generator trains. And they're independent, so it's an independent module of each unit. So it's a slightly different design than the base design.
Yes.
The multi-shaft is the base proposal.
The single shaft is proposed as an alternative.
Has that been decided?
It has not. And that's why we're including both in the application. And you also hear about, at least from a noise perspective, about both of those from Mr. Hancock, if you speak some of them.
Figures 4A and 4B are the same multi-shaft and single-shaft differentiation between A and B, so they're very similar. These are what you would call a plot plan or a general arrangement, and they were developed by the actual instructor of the facility and design engineer of record. Hewitt is the engineer for Pierre Construct firm that's partnered to do the project. And the plot plan shows the details of all the equipment that's associated with the power generation facility. This does not show the laydown area. It has a legend that identifies what each piece of equipment is. You can follow the legend back to the drawing and find out where it is. It's drawn to scale. It's at the same scale and background as all the other drawings. Even the
so is the scale is to the property line?
Yes. So you can put a scale on there and measure if it's not connected.
And these are drawn to scale, Mr. Benucci, because that's a requirement of the use our products.
Okay. Probably the best way to get a visual understanding of the project is figures 5A and 5B. Those are. Give a chance to pull it.
Yeah.
Sorry. You are. It's a smaller size.
Yes. Right behind those,
it's a manhole in color. These are known as site renderings. There's a figure 5A for the multi-shaft and a figure 5B for the single shaft configuration. They provide a three-dimensional bird's eye view of the facility, so it's easy visualization to convert from the other two-dimensional drawings into what the actual plant design will look like. And it shows the surrounding hillside sloping and some of the vegetation. And it gives you a good understanding visually of the elevation of the equipment and the
Did Mr. Wheatman, you're aware that the Jessup zoning ordinance requires the preparation and submission of what's called an environmental assessment?
Yes, I am.
And HDR prepared portions of the environmental assessment that's in this application, which is tab one of the application, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Could you walk us through the principal parts that HDR was responsible for?
Okay. One of the items that was evaluated was an assessment of fire and explosion hazards. We also did an evaluation of potential vibrations. There was an examination of the issue of the transfer of products and waste.
Did that include the development of a waste management plan?
Yes.
Could you explain?
Yes. The former use of the facility with the Jessup Borough dump required an assessment of the conditions at the site and the development of a project waste management plan. That plan was reviewed and approved by Pennsylvania DEP, and it establishes the procedures for all construction activities on site that include excavation. Prior to any excavation or during any excavation, there's air quality monitoring for combustible gases or for toxics. And then the policy and procedures are also established for when material is encountered, if it were to be encountered during the excavation, how it is stockpiled, stored, identified. This all needs to be done. It's an owner obligation to do it themselves or have their own designated, properly qualified OSHA certified inspector on site to manage.
Just to be clear, no portion of this plant is proposed to be built over the boundary of the area that is the former dump site, is that correct?
That's correct.
But this waste management plan has been developed and approved by PEDA in the on the chance, in the event that in the process of excavation and construction, we run into waste that may have been deposited there outside those boundaries.
Yes.
Did you also, did HDR also study soil and subsurface conditions at the site and any potential subsidence, particularly as a result of the former mining operations?
Yes, there was a preliminary, it's known as a geophysical investigation that was performed to look for any underground voids from former mining operations and to evaluate the potential for subsidence. The preliminary geophysical investigation determined that there was some potential voids. They were at very deep depth, approximately 80 feet below the current site grade elevations in the area where they were encountered. What is going to be performed as the project is constructed and goes forward is there will be further investigation that's done once the overburden material is removed, and there will be about 30 feet of material less to do the investigation through, so the results will be more reliable. And then at that time, if there are any potential voids that are encountered, if it's deemed necessary to fill them, the grout material will be ejected.
Did you also consider the existence of any wetlands at the site?
Yes, it's a rather thick report in the environmental assessment, but there's a wetland delineation that's been performed. And with the project change in design from a wet pool to an air pool system, there are no facilities that are in the wetland area, and there's no impact to wetlands in the proposed property.
Did HDR also analyze any potential traffic impacts?
Yes, we did. For the operational portion of the project, with the 30 full-time staff that are traveling to and from the project site, there will be no appreciable impact on local roads or traffic. Our traffic analysis focused primarily on the two-year construction phase, and it evaluated the intersections that would be the most common route to the project site. Route 247, same kind of way we came here tonight. And there are some recommendations for some improvements to be made temporarily during the construction phase, which is approximately 2 years.
Have you had an action?
Yes.
clear, nothing that's being proposed here will be at any cost to you. Let's switch to, there's an assessment in the environmental assessment regarding surface and groundwater, correct?
Correct.
Could you go through that for us?
Surface and groundwater contamination will be prevented through pest management practices or PMPs during construction and altering operation.
And what are PMPs?
They're a series of engineering design and operation and maintenance procedures to ensure the prevention of pollution to water bodies. And they deal primarily, in most people's minds, with stormwater runoff and sedimentation, but this project also includes an industrial NPDES permit for industrial wastewater discharge. And the treated wastewater will go to the same location as the stormwater, which is fast.
Could you explain what you mean by treated industrial wastewater?
Okay. The permitting process includes...
this is permitting with PDEP?
Yes, Pennsylvania DEP has what they call Part 1 and Part 2 industrial wastewater discharge permitting program. The DEP sets the discharge limits. And in this case, you're going to be looking at water quality, sedimentation from the runoff, and also temperature as it discharges into grasslands. Since the very nearby water stream is the Lackawanna River, and that's designated as a high quality water body, there's a Pennsylvania anti-degradation policy in place that is being utilized for this project during the permitting process by the DEP. And what that does is it looks at the all the discharge from both the constituents and the volume basis and determines permit limits that do not degrade the water body from an aquatic life and food chain perspective.
These are viewed, or these are considered stringent limits?
Yes, they're very stringent limits to the anti-degradation policy. There are an example of one constituent where the it's copper discharge limit that we're currently looking at in draft permit is lower than the raw water supply to the facility, which is Pennsylvania American Water Supply, the municipal government.
I'm sorry.
He's okay.
At least he's not saying.
So if I understand it correctly, at least with respect to that constituent, the water coming out of the facility will be purer than the water that comes into the facility. Can you explain how the water will be treated?
We're not using drinking water. That's typically a technology that's used for drinking water supply. What we're doing for the copper is essentially putting in a clarifier, adding certain flocculants that will get it to precipitate out. So we'll be using a chemical mechanical process.
So there will be an actual physical water treatment system.
Yes,
that's a site.
There's a wastewater treatment facility that will be required to meet these limits.